Welcome to FX Bootcamp London. My name is Christian Stevens. Today is Tuesday, March 1st, 2011. This is your daily London session video, a review of some of what we did today in the live London session class at fxbootcamp.com. Let me first remind you that the purpose of FX Bootcamp is education. We are not an alert service. Myself nor any of the other currency coaches will ever make any direct trade recommendations throughout the course of a session. Please be mindful that trading under leverage is always risky business. Occasionally, as a novice trader using excessive leverage, it might work for you. Unfortunately, more times than not, it will work against you. So please don't trade real money until you have a proven track record of success on a broker's free demonstration account. And even with that, though, always remember that past performance does not predict future results. Just simply don't trade money you can't afford to lose. One more thing before we get started, whether you're watching this video on YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, or our blog at FX Street, I'd like to ask that you please leave any sort of a comment once you're done watching. We'd love to hear from you one way or the other. Well, today certainly wasn't as good of a follow-through day as we had yesterday, which was just absolutely amazing for a Monday. We had a little bit of difficulty determining direction, but you know, we had some resistance to work with. Now, we looked at several pairings, but I'm going to talk about the pound-dollar in the trade we did on this that essentially took hours to develop, but it ultimately did end up paying off in the pip department. However, you know, may just be the tip of the iceberg. So what we found ourselves looking at here, if I look at the pound dollar, this is right at the London Open, is we had been rising. There was a pretty decent long in pre-London if you had taken advantage of it just before the open, from 62.50 zone up to about 63, but we had already planned to look for a short essentially around that 63-ish area simply due to the M4 weekly reversal pivot point at 63.17. But you don't want to get in the habit of trying to pick the top of something that just rose on a 4-hour chart. Here's your 4-hour chart for the past couple of days, that dramatically without some, you know, something showing you or giving you some indication that there's other people shorting there at the same time. You know, you want to make sure you're not the only schmuck trying to get short. And if I pull up a daily chart, you know, and just look back here, this area right around 53 here, this area has clearly been an area of resistance. So, you know, that information, along with the trend line coming down on the weekly, along with the M4 weekly reversal pivot point, and simply put, how far we had gone away from the daily five, gave us a good reason to try to shoot for a short back down to near that five around 62.25, which has been an area of support on its own right as a target. And if I look at a 2-hour chart, you can see that indicated here by this blue line at the 21 EMA. So the idea was to try to find a way to get short near the top, targeting around 62, 25, or 30 or so, but fully understanding that we are going to find a lot, and I do mean a lot, of support here right around this 62, 60 zone. Okay? So that was our plan, and it was just a matter of you know, how long is this going to take to play out, and is it something that's going to be an intraday scalp or something that's going to be a spot trade? You know, I think the answer to that question is both, and you have to decide whether you're hanging on to this and giving it that shot, knowing that you're probably going to pick up a significant amount of bulls right around that 62.60 zone. So that was pretty much our trade plan. Then it was a matter of execution about, look, how are we going to get short this? At what point are we going to make the decision to take the short? And what we did is we looked at the pivot point, which again is at 63.17, and we went to a short-term chart. If I can pull this up here, making lower lows now, I'm liking that. Okay, and right when this was breaching that area, here we go, on a 1-minute chart, all I wanted to see was just some sort of look. Let's make sure that we have other people willing to sell it. Let that swing happen. And like I was telling the room, start to look for additional selling pressure. And if you're very conservative, you could wait for a lower high. I was looking more for an aggressive short. Remember, this is right at London Open. So the way I'm looking at this is we are at resistance right at London Open. I'm looking for a fade scalp back down to sort of 62.60, capture 50, 60, 70 pips. And then maybe we'll come off of there and find a more conservative, slower short later, you know, that we could rely on. So we took the plunge here right about 63.20. Okay, that's where we got short on this, everybody in the room. And with the stop at 63.35, I think it was initially. And this is what it started to do. Then you got yourself a lower high. Well, I'm not going to sit here and go through the whole one-minute cycle for every swing, because basically this took a long period of time, but we'll get that all in one window there. Basically what happens is we finally come down to our first fib zone, which we expected to find a level of buying to take place. Let me recenter that. I want to get the hang on a second. Let me get that last swing in there. Let me just get the whole thing. Okay. So we expected the bottom here, which would be of this swing here, to the top. That is the last major swing on a short-term chart. Oh, there you go. Just watching my trade here. So we expected to find some buying pressure somewhere in here, and that this would take a long time to roll over, probably an hour or two, and it turns out it took even a little bit longer than that. And essentially, this trying to scalp this down. And once this got back up to the highs after the swing fib, then I could look for more of a fib of the entire move. That would be the next step, at which point right around 85, you'd probably pick up some buyers, 85 to 90. And you can see that happened pretty much like clockwork right around 4:15 in the morning Eastern time. That was an aggressive bump, though, and we had lowered our stop from 35 to 30, which was the higher high plus spread plus a couple pips. And if you look here, it went to 27.30. I survived on one of my platforms, but not on the GFT platform. So I guess if you tightened your stop a little too much, you might have gotten plucked. But if you did get plucked, you did have an opportunity to, you know, get back in once this started to head back down, if you chose to do so. I stayed in this with that same stop and barely survived it. But that was the last time we tested those highs. And once that had failed to make the new high, remember, we had already come down and tested the 90 area here, okay? And if I zoom out a 15-minute chart, you can certainly see why this was an area of why is this working? Not working. Highlighter. Sorry. Right here. You can certainly see why that was a roll reversing area. That was also a fib between here and here. And why you picked up buyers, it was also your 15-minute 21 EMA. And you know, once that area has been respected, I no longer really expect for that area to necessarily hold. In other words, I expect it now to, if we make a lower high or fail to make a higher high at least, that the next time we come down here, I'm expecting to go to the next zone, which is all the way down at 62.60, basically the hourly 21 EMA. And as I'm making this video, that is exactly where we find ourselves. So this trade took a lot longer than we expected. This is now a target. So you could take profit on that trade right now, unless you're trying to hang in for the bigger trade. Thing is, if you're trying to hang in for the bigger trade, there's a very good chance you're going to come all the way back up here and sort of test highs again before that maybe even happens. End result, though, is I'm expecting this to work its way down to at least 62.25. And if you choose to take profit on this trade right now, you're sitting here approximately at our target for last night, about 60 pips. Nothing's wrong with that for an intraday trade. And we'll see where this goes from here. The other element of this is on the euro pound. When we started to fall was right when the euro pound had found its support. This 4 hour down here, right when the euro pound had found its next support level here, okay, you can see the several tests that we've had on that, and right when that found the support, that means that you're going to get a little bit of a rise on the euro pound back to the next level of resistance, which we've now hit. But while that rise is taking place, it's going to mean a weak pound, in addition to the fact that we've already hit the resistance independently on pound dollar. This same trade, by the way, was available on pound yen, pound Swissie. Anything pound was at a place where it needed a little bit of a pullback, and some pairs pulled back more than others. You can see the pound yen came off pretty nice off of its daily M4 reversal pivot point at 3,400. It's now dropped. It's even a better trade than the pound dollar ultimately was. But this is just one of the trade plans we did today at FXBootcamp.com. It was a rather slow London, and it, you know, remains to be seen if we're going to get any more out of this trade. I do expect that if we do get more out of this, that the 62.25 to 30 area is going to provide a pretty decent, powerful long opportunity that may ultimately end up being a lower high, up around 63 again. But I think you're going to get a lot of buying pressure around there should we happen to get there. But nevertheless, that was one of the trade plans we did today at FXBootcamp.com. Hope you guys had a great day, and I'll see you next time. Cheers.